हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज़ नववर्ष, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सीएससी, इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज बीकानेर। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैव स्टडीड अबाउट फ्लो कंट्रोल मैकेनिज्म्स ऑफ डेटा लिंक लेयर। सो वन मोर फंक्शनैलिटी ऑफ डेटा लिंक लेयर इज़ एक्सेस कंट्रोल। एक्सेस कंट्रोल इज नथिंग बट विच इफ मोर देन वन स्टेशन हैज़ डेटा टू ट्रांसफ़र, so which station will send the data, so how we decide it is basically access control. So each station has a right to the medium without being controlled by any other station. So however, if more than one station tries to send, then there can be a conflict or collision and the frames will be either destroyed or modified. To avoid the excess conflict or to avoid the conflict or to resolve it whenever it happens, each station has to follow a procedure. So they can mutually decide when can the station access the medium, what can the station do if the medium is busy, how can the station determine the success or failure of the transmission, or what can the station do if there is any excess conflict or if there is any collision. So for that purpose, basically we have four mechanisms we have in computer networking. First one is pure Aloha, then slotted Aloha, CSMA CD, and then CSMA CA. First three protocols we have for wired communication, and CSMA CA is basically used for wireless communication. CSMA CD is collision control, carrier sense multiple access collision detection, and CSMA CA is carrier sense multiple access collision avoidance. So we will see them one by one. Okay, so this is the frames in a pure Aloha network. In pure Aloha network, what we are doing is only station. Let's suppose we have four stations. Okay, it is basically pure Aloha is the earliest random access method, and it is there. The original Aloha protocol original Aloha protocol, and a modified version of it is slotted Aloha. Basically, the idea is that each station sends a frame whenever it has a frame to send. Simply, whenever a station has a frame to send, it will simply send. However, since there is only one channel to share, there is a possibility of collision between the frames. So let's take an example. Let's suppose we have four frames, and this is station one sends the frame number 1.1 here. Then wait a minute. Okay, so here frame number 1.1, then it has frame number 1.2, station 2 has frame number 2.1 here, frame number 2.2, station 3 has frame number 3.1 and 3.1. This is timeline. Okay, so station 4 has frame number 4.1 and frame number 4.2. So see here, this is the area of collision. When you are sending in a time frame, if you are sending more than one frame, then there may be a collision between these frames. Here is also a collision. So okay, we will next see the concept of okay, this is the procedure for a pure Aloha method. See, whenever there is a collision occurs, so what the station should do. So an algorithm known as back of timer algorithm is used. Just a minute. An algorithm known as back of a timer algorithm is used to detect detect collision in pure Aloha. So we have K is the number of attempts, TP is the maximum propagation time, प्रोपेगेशन टाइम इज नथिंग बट द टाइम टेकन बाय द फ्रेम टू रीच टू क्रॉस द चैनल. TFR इज द एवरेज ट्रांसमिशन टाइम फॉर अ फ्रेम. TB इज द बैक ऑफ टाइम. सो वी आर स्टार्टिंग. स्टेशन हैज अ फ्रेम टू सेंड. सो इनिशियली K इज इक्वल टू जीरो एंड स्टेशन विल सेंड द फ्रेम. देन इट विल वेट फॉर वेट टाइम. सो इट विल वेट फॉर 2 इंटू TP टाइम. बेसिकली दिस 2 इंटू TP टाइम इज द टाइम फॉर विच द कोलिजन अकर्स. वी विल सी इट लेटर. देन इट विल वेट whether the ACK received. If yes, then success. If no, ACK doesn't arrive. That means there is some collision. So if there is a collision, so what this station will do, it will increase the value of K is equal to K plus 1, and then it will check whether K is greater than K plus K max. So we have already decided number of attempts, how many times a station can attempt within a particular time period. So if K is greater than K max, then we will stop here. If it is not, if it is false, then K max is a normally, it generally we take it as 15. Okay, so if it is not greater than K maximum, then again choose a random number R between 0 and 2 power K minus 1. So we will choose randomly, we will choose a number. So this is a randomized algorithm basically. So again wait TB. So TB is nothing but the back of time, or you can say the waiting time. So wait for TB time, and TB we will calculate based on that random number and TP. TB can be R multiplied by TP or R multiplied by TFR. TFR is average transmission time and TP is propagation time. So based on propagation and transmission time, we can calculate waiting time. Again, this will go to this. Again, this loop will be repeated. So this is the procedure. So whenever there is a collision, so what happens whenever there is a collision with one station, in the next station, see, we are increasing the value of K. So the waiting time of, and we are here, we are taking the random variable R. So if let's suppose if two stations send the data simultaneously, okay, so which parameter is here to differentiate the next time zone of sending the data of the two station? We are taking here, we are taking the random variable R. So it is random, so it is very less probability of two random numbers to be similar. So if one station generate random number as 5, so second station may get 7 or 6 or 1, like that. So this waiting time will be different. So this waiting time will be different. So if let's suppose the two stations S1 and S2 are there, and for S1 R is generated as 2, and for S2 R is generated as 4. So again we have to calculate R into TP. So this will be, so these two numbers will be very large. Okay, so there will be a huge difference between the sending time of the two stations. So there will be less possibility of collision. So like this, the pure aloha detect and correct the collision or prevent collision. Okay, so next, okay, this is the vulnerable time for pure aloha. What is vulnerable time? Vulnerable time is the time in which there is a possibility of collision. So we'll calculate vulnerable time based on transmission time or propagation time. So see, here this is, let's suppose T minus TFR, and this is T plus TFR. TFR is the transmission time, and TFR is the average transmission time. So okay, so this is T minus TFR, and this is T plus TFR. So one station send this data, this is the beginning and ending of the frame, and B's end. So this is B station, and this is the frame of A station. So from here A starts to send the data, so A begin and A ends here, and some other station C is here. So this is the frame of the data, the C. So see, the sizes of the frames are always same. Fixed size frames are there. So and the transmission time and propagation time is also same for every frame. So what is the vulnerable time? This is the time T, and this is the time T plus TFR. this is nothing but the transmission time of this frame. So this is what is TFR. So at T, if you start to send the frame at TFR time, you will cover the channel. So basically, what is the vulnerable time? See, from here to here, we can get collision. So here can also one frame can be there like this. Okay, so from here to here we can get the collision. So what is the vulnerable time here? It will be T plus TFR minus T minus TFR. So it will be 2 into TFR. So vulnerable time is nothing but the twice of the transmission time in pure Aloha. Okay, so we'll take an example. Let's suppose a pure Aloha network transmit 200 bit frames on a shared channel of 200 kbps. What is the requirement to make this frame collision free? So average frame transmission time TFR, so we'll calculate TFR, which is 200 divided by 200, it come out to be 1 millisecond. So the vulnerable time will be 2 into TFR, that is 2 millisecond. So this means no station should send later than 1 millisecond before this station start transmission, and no station should start sending during the 1 millisecond period this station is sending. Means whenever this station is sending before 1 millisecond and after 1 millisecond, no station should transmit the data. Okay. So the throughput of pure Aloha is G into e power minus 2G. Here G is nothing but the load of the channel. So maximum throughput which have been already calculated is 0.184. So it is when G is equal to 1 by 2, means 50% load is there, then we can achieve the maximum throughput, which is 18.4%. So if from pure Aloha we can only get the throughput of 18.4%. Okay, next we have an example, a pure Aloha network. Let's suppose it transmits 200 bit frames on a shared channel of 200 kbps. What is the throughput of the system? If the system produces 1000 frames per second, 500 frames per second and 250 frames per second. So the frame transmission time is again 1 millisecond. So if the system creates 1000 frames per second, so we will calculate, see, G is the load, and load is nothing but how many frames a system or you can say the channel is generating in particular propagation in transmission time. So in 1 millisecond, how many frames are generating? 1000 frames. So we can say 1 frame per millisecond. Okay, per second it is generating 1000 frames. So in 1 frame is equal to 1 millisecond. So the load here is 1. So again we will put the value, so S is come out to be 0.134, so it is 13.5% approximately. So the throughput is 135 frames. From only 135 frames out of 1000 will probably survive. Rest all the frames will be collided. Okay, again if you calculate for 500, so again for 500 the G come out to be 1 by 2. So we can again calculate from this. So G is 1 by 2. So we can calculate G into e power minus 2G. So here it is. Sorry, it is for 1000. Okay, so here it is 15.2%. Again, we take for the third number. So here, for G is equal to 1 by 2, it is 18.4%. So as we have already seen, if the load is 50%, then throughput will be 18.4%. So when the when we have 250 frames per second, so the load is 1 by 4, so we will get 15.2%. Okay, again, frames in a slotted Aloha network. So in slotted Aloha network, what we do is, we extend the pure Aloha method. So pure Aloha has a vulnerable time of 2 into TFR. So this is why, because there is no rule that defines when the station can send the data. A station may send as soon as it has a data to be sent. Slotted Aloha was invented to improve the efficiency of pure Aloha. So in slotted Aloha, we divide the time into slots of TFR and force the station to send only at the beginning of the time slot. So whenever a station has a data to send, it has to wait for the next slot, and then in that particular slot only the station can send the data. So this is slot 1, slot 2, slot 3, 4, 5 and 6. So station 1 has data, it can be sent within this slot. Station 2 has data to send, let's suppose if here station 2 has data to send, so it cannot be sent, it has to send within this slot only, like this. So what is the vulnerable time? So the throughput of the slotted Aloha is g into e power minus g. So S maximum is come out to be 0.368, where g is equal to 1. So how much throughput we are achieving? 36.8%. Okay, so if we calculate the vulnerable time, so it is nothing but it is simple, it is TFR. Why? Because in TFR time only there can be a collision of the frame, because we are sending in this particular time only. So if only one station send the data, so there will be no collision. If in that particular slot more than one station send the data, then there can be collision. So vulnerable time is TFR here. It is equal to the transmission time. Okay, the same example we will repeat for slotted Aloha. So here only G value is changed. So the frame the formula for the throughput is S is equal to G into e power minus G. The frame transmission time is 200 upon 200 kbps, which is equal to 1 millisecond. So if the system creates 1000 frames per second, this is equal to 1 frame per millisecond. So again the load is 1. As in this case we have S is equal to G into e power minus G, which is equal to 36.8%. So as we know, the throughput is maximum when we have load is equal to 1. In the pure Aloha, when the load was 1 by 2, G is equal to 1 by 2, we were achieving the maximum throughput. Here, if G is equal to 1, then we will achieve maximum throughput, which is 36.8%. So this means only 386 frames out of 1000 will probably survive and rest will collide. So here the efficiency is just double than pure Aloha. If the system creates 500 frames per second, so this is the G will be 1 by 2. So 1 by 2 frames per millisecond, so load is 1 by 2. So S will be 30.3%. So this means out of 500 only 150 frames will probably survive. Again, if the system creates 250 frames per second, the G is here 1 by 4. So we'll calculate S, that is throughput. It come out to be 0.195, so it is 19.5%. So this means only 14, if we calculate 19.5% of 250, then it come out to be 49. So only 49 frames out of 250 will survive and the rest will collide with each other. Okay. So these were the protocols for Aloha and pure Aloha. And next we have another protocol, which is something different from the previous ones. It is CSMA. CSMA is Carrier Sense Multiple Access. So we use one concept which is known as sensing the channel before sending the data. So to minimize the chance of collision and therefore increase the performance, the CSMA method was developed. The chance of collision can be reduced if a station senses the medium before trying to use a carrier. So before sending the data, if the station try to know whether the channel is busy or not, if it is busy, so it can then I will wait, then there is a less probability of collision. So carrier sense multiple access requires that each station first listen to the medium or check the state of the medium before sending. State can be busy or idle. So in other words, CSM is based on the principle sense before transmit or listen before talk. So the possibility of collision still exists because of propagation delay. There is also a possibility of a collision because of a propagation delay. So why? Because we will see it later. When a station sends a frame, it still takes time for the first bit to reach every station and for every station to sense it. See, a station can sense only only a station can sense collision only when the particular bit which is sent by some other station reaches to that particular station. Okay, so a station may sense the medium and find it idle only because the first bit sent by another station has not yet been received. Okay, so this is the space or time model of the collision in CSMA. So this is four stations are there, A, B, C and D. So at time T1, B starts sending the data, and at time T2, C tries to send the data. But at this particular time T2, the A's data has not been sent to the C. So C will simply send the data. Okay, so what is the vulnerable time in CSMA? So here vulnerable time is equal to the propagation time. Okay, so let's suppose if B senses collision here, and C senses here, and D senses here. So this is what is the frame propagation time. So if station A, if two different station, see station A send the data from here, and let's suppose station B wants to transmit here. So from here to here, what is the time? It is nothing but the propagation time of the channel. So it is equal to, simply vulnerable time is equal to propagation time in CSMA. Okay, next we have three methods for sensing the data. Three persistent methods are there. So what should a station do if the idle, if the channel is busy? What should a station do if the channel is idle? So to decide these things, we have three methods. First one is one persistent method. In one persistent method, it is just very simple and straightforward. In this method, after the station the station will continuously sense the channel, and after the station finds the line idle, it will send its frame immediately. Okay, so whenever the station finds the channel idle, it will send the data. Okay, so but here this particular carrier sense method has the highest chances of collision. Okay, non-persistent, next one we have non-persistent. In non-persistent method, a station that has a frame to send will sense the channel. If the line is busy, if the channel is busy, then it will send immediately. If the channel is not free, then it will wait for a random amount of time, and then again it will sense the channel. So before sensing, see in first method, the station was continuously sensing the channel. In the second non-persistent method, the first it will the station will sense the channel, and if it is busy, then it will wait. Then again, it will change. Then it will wait, and then it will sense. And whenever it is free, then it will immediately transmit. But for two sensing time, it has some random amount of time. So that random thing prevents the collision. Okay, for the third one is P persistent method. The P persistent method is used if the channel has the time slot with a slot duration equal to or greater than maximum propagation time. So what we are doing, we have decided a time slot here, and the channel will continuously sense the data, and whenever there is whenever the channel is idle, so what it will do is there is a probability P and Q. So with probability P, if it will the station will send its frame. Okay, with probability Q, which is equal to 1 minus P, the station waits for the beginning of the next time slot, and then it will check the line again. So again, if the line is idle, it goes to step again, it will calculate probability P. So whenever the channel is idle, the station will send the data with P probability. Okay, so this is the flow diagram of the three persistent methods. In one persistent, the channel is idle, then station will transmit. If busy, then again it continuously it will sense. If the channel is busy here, it will wait for a random amount of time. If the channel is idle, then it will send and it will repeat, it will be repeated. Okay, in P persistent method, if the channel is busy, so it will use a backup process as though collision occurs, and if it is idle, then it will continuously sense. Okay, if it is busy, then it will continuously sense, and if it is idle, then it will calculate the probability. If it is less than equals to P, the station can, it is greater than equals to P, the station can transmit. If it is less than P, then if it is greater than P, then it will wait for a slot. If it is less than equals to P, station can transmit the data. Okay, so till now we have discussed about what is CSMA. Okay, but we have not discussed how can we remove the collision in CSMA. So to avoid the collision, we have another protocol, CSMA CD. So CSMA with CD, carrier sends multiple access with collision detection. So CSMA method does not specify the procedure following a collision. CSMA CD augments the algorithm to handle the collision. In this method, a station monitors the medium after it sends a frame to see if the transmission was successful. If so, the station is finished. If, however, there is a collision, the frame is resent. Okay, so this is the timing diagram of CSMA CD. So see, at time T1, station A has executed the persistent procedure, or it has executed the sensing procedure, and again, and it finds the channel idle and starts sending the bits of its frames. Okay, so at time T2, let's suppose if station C has not sensed this particular bit of station A has not received by the D. So at this point, station C wants to send the, at the time T2, station C wants to send the data, but the bit of A has not been received by the C. So C, for C, it seems like the channel is idle. So C will again start to send the data. Okay, which propagates in both the direction, left and right. Data always flows in both the directions. Okay, so the collision occurs sometimes. Let's suppose after T2, station C detects a collision at, let's suppose, time T3. At time T3, station C detects the collision and it aborts the transmission. Station A detects the collision at T4. When the bit of C reaches to A, it will detect the collision, and again A will abort the transmission. Okay, so likewise, looking at the figure, we see that the A has transmitted for duration T4 minus T1, and C has transmitted for T3 minus T2. So length, so what we do is we divide the length of frame. Okay, so that the length of the frame is divided by the bit rate in this protocol. So that length should be more than either of the two durations, this duration and this duration. So okay, next, this is the procedure of the collision I have already discussed. Okay, collision and abortion in CSMA CD. This is the clear diagram. Okay, next we have the flow diagram of CSMA CD. So it is something similar to your Aloha. Okay, so one difference is here. So the first difference is the addition of the persistent process. In Aloha, we were not using the persistent method, and here we have to use persistent method, then only we can transmit the data. Okay, and the second difference is the frame transmission. In Aloha, we first transmit the entire frame and then wait for the acknowledgement. In CSMA CD, transmission and collision detection is a continuous process. So we do not send the entire frame and then look for the collision. The station transmits and receives continuously and simultaneously, and then it uses a loop to show that transmission is a continuous process. We constantly monitor in order to detect one of the two conditions. Either the transmission is finished or there is a collision. So either event stops the transmission. When we come out of the loop, if a collision has not been detected, then it means that the transmission is complete and the entire frame has been transmitted. Otherwise, there is a collision. Okay. Next, this is the energy level during transmission. You see, whenever there is a normal transmission, this is the energy level of the channel. And if collision is there, then the energy level will be very much higher. So, what is the size we will take for the CSMA? If two stations involved in a collision are maximum distance apart, the signal from the first takes the time TP, which is the propagation time, to reach the second station, and the effect of the collision takes another time TP to reach the first. Means first TP to detect the collision and one TP to get the information about the collision. So 2 TP time. So the requirement is that the first station must still be transmitting after 2P time. So this 2P time we will take, minimum frame size we will take is 2P, 2 TP, so that the whole frame is not transmitted in the 2P time, 2 TP time. Throughput of CSMA CD is greater than that of pure Aloha. The maximum throughput occurs at a different value of G, and which is based upon the persistent method and the value of P. For one persistent method, the maximum throughput is 50% when G is equal to 1. And for non-persistent method, the maximum throughput can go up to 90% when G is, if we take the G between 3 and 8. So G is nothing but the load. Okay. So this was CSMA CA. Next we have this was CSMA CD. Next we have CSMA CA. Carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance. So the basic idea of CSMA CD was that a station needs to be able to receive while transmitting to detect a collision. So when there is no collision, the station receives one signal. When there is no collision, so what happens is that whenever a station has to transmit the data will be broadcasted in all the directions. So whenever there is no collision, the station will receive its own signal. And when there is a collision, the station receives two signals. One is its own signal and the another one is the second station. So two different distinguish between these two cases, the received signal in these two cases must be significantly different. So in other words, the signal from the second station needs to be add a significant amount of energy to the one created by the first station, because we have already seen the energy diagram. So energy diagram shows that at the time of collision, the energy is increased up to a huge level. So however, in a wireless network, much of the sent energy is lost in transmission, so the received signal has very less energy. Okay, so we don't consider about that. It is only a 5-10% additional energy, so this is not useful. So collision detection we don't apply on wireless channels. So for wireless channels we take collision avoidance. Okay, so in for collision avoidance, collisions are avoided by deferring transmission even if the channel is found idle. So basically, when an idle channel is found, the station does not send immediately. It waits. Whenever in a wireless channel, if the channel is idle, the channel does not send immediately. It waits for a period of time which is known as inter-frame spaced or IFS time. Even though the channel may appear idle while it is sensed, a distant station may have already started transmitting. So this is the reason to take this IFS time. The distant station signal has not reached to this station, so the IFS time slot allows the front of the transmitted signal by the distant station to reach this station. So this is the time we take to detect any kind of collision. If the after the IFS time the channel is idle, the station can send, but still there is a need to wait for a time which is equal to contention time. okay, the IFS variable can also be, contention time we'll see later, the IFS time can also be used to prioritize the stations. For example, if a station that is assigned a shorter IFS has a higher priority. Okay, next we have contention time. So this contention window is an amount of time divided into slots. A station that is ready to send chooses a random number of slots as its waiting time. The number of slots in the window changes according to the binary exponential backoff strategy. Again, we are as the pure Aloha, we are here also, we are taking backoff exponential algorithm. This means that it is set to one slot the first time and then doubles each time the station cannot detect an idle channel after the IFS time. So whenever, if the channel is not idle, then waiting time will be doubled every time. So station needs to sense the channel after each time slot. However, if the station finds the channel busy, it does not restart the process. It just stops the timer and restart it when the channel is idle. So this is the thing. If the channel is busy, then it will stop the process and again it will start. This gives the priority to the station with the longest waiting time. So this basically this prevents starvation. And one more thing we have here is acknowledgement. So the positive acknowledgement and the timeout timer can also help guarantee that the receiver has received the frame, as we have seen in sliding window protocol about timeout and acknowledgement. Okay, so this is the timing in CSMA/CD. This is the channel is busy, then it will wait for IFS. Whenever it is idle, it will wait for IFS time. Then it will base the contention window is here. Then it will send the frame. This is the flow diagram of CSMA/CA. Okay, we'll see it. Just a minute. Okay. Starting time, then K is equal to 0. If the channel is idle, then it will wait for IFS time. If the channel after IFS time, it is still idle, then it will choose a random number R between 0 to 2 power k minus 1. I mean, it will apply the algorithm. If it is not idle, then again this whole procedure will be started. The whole procedure will be started. And if the channel is not idle, then again it will go to here. So again, after choosing the random number R, it will wait for R slots. Okay, then after completing the R slots, it will send the frame. Then again wait time out. If there is any time out, then again retransmit. If ACK received, then yes, success. If we did not receive the ACK, then K will be increased. Again, K will, if we will compare, if K is greater than 15, yes, then abort. If it is no, then again it will go to this algorithm. Okay, this is how CSMA/CA performs. So thank you so much.